Hi, this is Vishal here from TrapCode. So in this video, we will see the basic understanding of TrapCode Builder, like how you can build web applications, what all different components are, different modules are, and how you can use them to build a full-fledged web applications. So let's start. So once you create a project, you land up on a screen like this. So this is what we call as Builder or a Builder console, where you build your web applications. So these are the core components or core modules of the system. So this button is like a component section where you can see a lot of components which can be used to design a web page, which can be used to display dynamic data, to have forms, to submit the values, pagination, crowds, and a lot more things, right? So these are the basic components which you can use to build your web applications. After components, we have sections. So sections are like a pre-built structure of UI layers, so that let's say you need something like a four column layout, three column layout. So you can just drag and drop and it will build that particular layout for you. After the components, we have pre-built sections. So these pre-built sections are like pre-built, pre-designed layouts, which you can use as it is in your project. So you don't have to design a lot of things from scratch. So this is basically just to fasten up your development time. So let's say you need a footer, you just go and drag and drop it like this. So the footer is here, right? And then you can change it as per your need, right? So this is the designing part. Apart from that, if you want to design things from scratch, so there are like several components which you can use as it is. So let's say I need a navbar on my page. So I just go and drop a navbar. It is here. I can change it to whatever I want. Okay, now let's say I need a paragraph or a header section, so I just drop a header. So header is here. I need a paragraph, I'll go and drop a paragraph. This is here. Let's say I need a hero section, I want to build my own hero section, so we go and drop a jumbotron. So jumbotron is here like this. So this is how you basically build a web page, right? And there are several UI changes, several cosmetic changes which you can do. So for that, we have a style manager. Here you can basically decide the style of all the components. So let's say, let's talk about this. So this is a heading. Maybe I want to put some width, so I can go and give a width. Let's say I want 200 pixels. Okay, so I just get 200 pixels. So now it is it. If I want to increase the width, I can just drag it like this, or I can give the width auto so that it takes the width of the parent component. After that, there is a concept of margin. So let's say you want to give some margin. So let's say margin of 20 pixel on the top, margin of 20 pixel on the bottom, margin left, margin right. Similarly with padding. So padding on the top, padding on the bottom, padding to the right, padding to the left. Okay, like this. So this is padding. Now we have typography, so where you can change the font. You can so we have like support of like 150 different font styles, so you can just change the font and the font will get changed. Okay, apart from font, you can play with font size, font width. Okay, so let's go and change the font size. So you see the font size increasing, font width and all. After that, we have font color. So if you want to play with the font color, you can change it, or you can put the color code of your choice so that it matches your theme, right? After that, there's a text alignment. So align left, align right, align center, and all those things. Okay. After that is a decoration layer. So let's say I want to give a background color, or maybe I want to use a background image. So we have a concept of background. So here you can either choose an image or either choose a color or you choose a gradient. Okay, so let's say if I want to put a color, then I can just simply go and choose the color. So this is how you design the background. After background, we have border. So you can put border in pixels. So let's say border of 2 pixel on the left, 2 pixel on the right, and then you can give the style solid, dotted, and all those things, right? So let's say 2 pixel, 2 pixel, and 2 pixel. Okay, if you want to take a look at like how your changes are coming up, so simply go and click the preview button. This will help you to see your application as it is shaping up in the real time. So once you click preview, it will show you what exactly you are designing. Now after border, we have border radius. So let's say if you want to have a rounded corner something, then you can go and choose the border radius. So let's say border radius of 10 pixel. Now if I go to preview, I will be able to see the rounded border, right, like this. After that, we have a support of animation. So let's say you want some animation. So we have like different type of animation. So let's say bounce, flash. So all these things are here. So you can actually apply animations also to your UI elements. And then you can control the duration. You can control the delay. You can control the iteration. Okay. If you want to dig more into designing, then we have a full support of flex layout. So this is how exactly you can design your pages. So you have all the UI components which you need to build your web page. So there are a couple of advanced sections also, like you need tabs, you need carousel, you need pre-built sections, you need charts. So all those are here. So example of carousel, right? Let's say you need a carousel like this. You just click it and that's all. Okay. Carousel is here. If you want to see how this looks like, again go to the preview and you see the carousel is here. I hope this is clear now. So next thing is pages. A web application consists of multiple pages, right? So whatever screens you want to build for your end user are called pages. So creating pages is quite simple in Drag Code. You go and click this edge page button, give the name of the page. So let's say I want a dummy page. Okay, so you give the page. This is the URL which is default, but if you want, you can change it. And then you just create it. There are other ways also. So let's say if you already created a page, you've already spent time on designing, so you can just kind of copy the content of that page. You choose the existing page and it will copy exactly the same design which is there in the other page, so that you don't have to build every time from scratch. Okay, so let's say I want to copy from page one. I'll just go and create. So now my dummy page is created and the content is coming from page one, right? So this was the default content on page one. So it is coming like this. So let's delete it. That's all. Now we will take a look at the links. So links are basically the components which are used to connect pages, right? So let's say I have a home page and from home page I want to navigate to my dummy page. So I can drop a link. Okay, or I can use some link which are already there on the pages. So let's say I have this feature link. I can link it to my page. So from here I'll say, okay, take me to the dummy page. Okay, or I can drop a link or a link box component which do the same. So let's say drop a link here and take me to a dummy page. Okay, and I can change the content. Let's say if I want, take me to. Let's go and see how this looks like. Here, if you see, we have linked this feature to the dummy page. So if we click it, it will take me to the dummy page. Okay, since we don't have any content on the dummy page, so it's showing like this. Okay, and this is also taking me to the same dummy page. After link, where we are covering collections, where we are giving the basic introduction of collections. So collections are basically the components or the module where you store your data so that it brings the dynamic behavior to your web application. So without data, any web application is static web application, right? So here you can create your schema, you can create collections, collect field, store data in it, get data from third-party APIs, push data to third-party APIs. So anything which is related to data gets stored in the collection. Let's go and create some simple collection. Okay, so let's say I want to store information of product. Okay, so let's go and create a product collection. So you give the name of the collection and hit the create button. Then you will see this screen. So now we are adding fields to the collection, right? So fields are something you can treat like a column in an Excel sheet. So you have multiple columns. So let's say in one column I want to save the name of the collection, which is of type text. So I'll say name, which is name of the product. Okay, now maybe I want to store a description about the product. So I'll go into a large text description. Okay, then maybe I want to put a date, manufacturing date. So I'll go and click this date. Okay, after it, maybe we want a drop down of a status. So I'll just go and put a static option in the values. Not available. Okay, so now we have created a very simple collection which has four attributes or four fields: name, description, manufacturing date, and status. Let's go and add data to it. So to add data, just click this button. So now you can see we are seeing a form which on the basis of the fields which we just created. Product one, some random description, manufacturing date, showing me date picker because I've mentioned it of type date, and the status, the values which we created while creating the collection. Okay. So this is how you basically store the data, and this data you can further use in your web application to display on different UI layers. Hope this is clear. Moving to our next topic, we will cover concept of dynamic data. So how we want to display dynamic data in the web page. So let's go back to our pages. So we have created this dummy page. On the dummy page, let's display the data. Okay, so display the data, we have a couple of CMS components which you can use to display data in different formats. So one is table. You can display data in the form of table, in the form of cards, or in the form of list. So let's use them one by one. So let's say I want to display my data in the form of table. So I'll just click this component and drop it on the canvas. Now it is asking me to choose the collection. I'll choose the collection, product, okay, and the filters. Filters are basically you can control like what type of data will get displayed. As of now, it's bringing all. Okay. So it creates a dummy table for me which has some predefined schema, but I can change it. I can move things here and there, I can remove item, I can add it. So basically I can control it as I want. Let's go and see how this looks like. So now it is bringing the data from the database, right? So this is the product which we created. So now let's display the data in the form of cards. So let's go and drop a data group. So here it is the card, same thing, you choose the collection, choose the filter, and then the data gets displayed. Now we will have to map that, okay, what we want to display at this particular field. Let's say I want to display my product name. So you choose the this field, get data from collection, and then the name of the product, which is good. Then maybe title. So here we want to display the description. Okay, here maybe we want to display the manufacturing date. Okay. That's all, and then we can remove these things. Okay. Now let's go and see how this looks like. So here you can see the data is coming in the table. Now the same data is coming in the form of cards. Okay, let's go and drop the list component. So data list, same thing, choose the collection, which choose the filter, that's all, right? Now we will need to bind this, that okay, what particular field of the product I want to display. So let's display the name. Let's go to preview again. Now data is coming in the form of list. Okay, so table, cards, and list. So you can display it in whatever format you want. You can design them using the style manager. Now the next thing we need to cover is a form. Okay, so let's say I want to create some data. Let's say the user of the application want to enter some data that should get displayed. So let's go and create a page. Okay, so let's say I give the name a form, and then I just create it. Let's go to the page. The forms page is there. So now let's go and drop some form components. Okay, so we have various type of forms for storing the data in the collection. We generally use collection form. So let's go and drop this collection form. Now once you drop the form, it will ask you that which particular collection you want to generate this form for. So I'll choose the collection product, and if you see, it has created a nice looking product form. Now I can use this form to create more and more products on the fly. So this is a concept of form. Currently, the form will not work because these forms need some sort of guidelines that what exactly needs to be done, some form of order, right? So that is something which we control from the event. So let's go and take a look at the events. So events is a tab on the left. You click it and click a new event. Okay. So events are basically a chain of actions which you can do on certain trigger. So here in this case, we want to store data in the product and then maybe redirect the user back to the list page where they can see the new product. So let's go and create an event. So I'll create an event called product create or create product. So now an event is created. So now we will add actions to the event. That first of all, let's go and save data. Right, save data. So if you can see in the event, there are like several type of events. You want to log the user in, sign up, sign in, log out, send an email, open pop-up, close pop-up, show something, hide something, some components, navigate to some other pages, send emails, send alert messages, notifications, save data to collection, update data, delete data, add data to a collection, send data to some third party APIs using webhooks, or maybe fetch data from Airtable, Google Sheet, in different data sources. So here in this example, we will just store the data in the collection. So we'll say in save data. We'll choose the collection, that in the product collection we want to save the data. Now after that, maybe we show some notification message. Let's say product created successfully. Name to create product. And that's all. After that, we want to redirect the user back to the list page where we're displaying several products. Okay, so I think that was the dummy page. That's all. Save it. Let's go and bind this event to the page. Okay, so let's go to the form page and bind the event. So in the collection form, here in the workflow event, I'll just choose the event which we just created. Let's go and see this in action. So again, I'll click the preview. The application is here, the product form is here. Let's go and add another product. Product. Okay. Manufacturing date and then status. Okay. So this is the UI which your end user will be going to see. Okay. And allow submit it. So what it should do, it will save the data, show some message and redirect me to the list page where we are displaying the list of products. Save the data, shown the message and taken me to the list page. Now you can see we have two products coming. Okay. And then in the cards also we have two products. In the list also we have two products. So we have just created some dummy data, stored it in the database and now displayed on the UI. So this covers the concept of collections and events together. Now let's take a look at assets. So assets are basically if you want to upload some images, some files, some static component. Also you can add it from here by drag and drop, or you can actually search images. So let's say I need images of cars. I can go and search images. So it will bring me copyright free images of like from an external library, which you can use in a project as it is. So let's edit this image. So the image is here, and then I can just drag and drop and use wherever I want it to use. Like this. Now we will see the concept of plugins, like what exactly plugins are. So let's go to the plugin tabs. So here we have like several pre-built plugins which you can use in your project. You just have to go and install. So let's say if you want to send in SMS, you go and install the Twilio plugin. If you want Google Analytics, just go and install the Analytics plugin. If you want to send emails, use SES plugin, right? So we have several plugins and we are adding more and more plugins as we go. Right? Google Maps, e-commerce, Twitter login, GitHub login, Atom Chat, and all those things. Okay. So let's go and install a login plugin. Okay. So this plugin brings the capability to secure an application, right? So we can control who will see what, right? So a typical web application has n number of roles, like n number of users. So we can restrict that which particular user will be able to see what. So I'll just go and install the login plugin. So these are a couple of configuration I want to give to my login plugin. Okay, and then just install the plugin. So the plugin is installed. Now if I go to my pages, I can see there are like few more pages got created. The login page, sign up page, forgot password, reset password. All these pages were created by the login plugin. And in the collection, we have two more collections, user and role. So we can go and create a number of roles. So let's say my application has a admin role. My application has a user role. Okay, or maybe let's change this user to employee. Okay, so let's say we have two roles. Admin and employee. Now if I go to my pages, I will be able to give permission that who is going to see what, right? So in the pages, if let's say if this form I want only the admin to be able to see, I can actually choose that users with admin role. So now the people who have this particular role will be able to see. Okay, now let's go and create a user with admin role. Okay, so I go to the user, click add user, first name is let's say admin, last name is admin, username is admin@gmail.com, password and the role. Here I can choose admin role. Now I have saved it. So let's go and try to access the page which has admin permissions, right? So okay, so this form is the page where we are saying that people with only admin role will be able to access. Let's go and try to access this page. Now if you see, it has taken me to the login page because I'm not authorized to see this. So let's go and log in with this admin. Now let's try to go to this page again. Now I can see this page. So basically only the person with admin role now can access this page. So you can control in your application that who visits which particular section. Lot more thing which can be done with roles, with permissions, with collections, with data sources, webhooks, plugin, but I think it's the purpose of this video is just to give you a quick introduction with the capabilities of the platform, like what all can be done. Hope this is useful. Thank you guys. Bye bye.